The Apostle Paul wrote to the Colossians, chapter 1, verse 17. God's beloved Son is before all things, and in him all things hold together. That is our New Testament word that comes from our Moravian Daily Text for today, January 20th. And it was without a doubt, if Brother Hopeton was here, what he would be sharing with you as he shared with all of us, whether it was a staff meeting, a hospital visit, the way to begin a morning devotion. The Moravian Daily Text reminds us of this truth that we know, that Christ is before us in all things, within us in all things, and holds us together, even now. Brothers and sisters, I welcome you to Central Moravian Church. We welcome you if you are here in person. We welcome you if you are joining us from probably every continent represented around this world where our Moravian unity stretches, brothers and sisters united in this Son who holds all things together. I thank you for coming as we remember the Right Reverend Hopeton Clennon, as we give thanks to God for his life, his ministry, his service, and his joy. And most of all, as we come before God to worship. Thank you for those representatives from provinces throughout our Moravian worldwide unity for being here and representing. Thank you to our fantastic choirs spanning three different eras of Bishop Hopeton's life. Thank you to all of you for your presence and your shared sorrow allows us to come together in worship and to be together and to make it through. We do hope that this service of celebration of this life well lived will continue in the sharing of remembrances and of friendships and of community as we join together over at Steel Stacks. Just across the bridge at Arts Quest. There's directions that would be available for you following the service, as well as the address in your bulletin. This entire worship service was designed by Brother Hopeton. Maybe not the snow part yesterday. But we did it, right? We're all here. This service, these hymns, these scriptures that we'll be sharing are ones that he selected for this day, reflections of who he was and where his faith was, but also reflections, I think, of what could carry us through in our corporate grief and our time together and how we will be comforted by the presence and the power of our God. And so I begin with the psalm that he selected as we call ourselves to worship, Psalm 16, that in my Bible is listed as a song of trust and security in God. Protect me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. As for the holy ones in the land, they are noble, in whom is all my delight. Those who choose another god will multiply their sorrows. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names upon my lips. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me. I keep the Lord always before me because he is in my right hand. I shall not be moved. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my soul rejoices, and my body also rests secure. For you do not give me up to Sheol, or let your faithful one see the pit. You show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. In your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Amen.
seated. Lord, our God, in whom we live and move and have our being. Lord, our God, you do not willingly bring affliction or grief to your children.
Be your peace with us.
Lord, our God, you have raised Christ from death as the assurance that those who sleep in death will also be raised.
Bless and comfort us, we humbly pray.
Eternal God, accept us as your children and your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, who came into the world from you, was born a human being, and lived among us. He took the role of a servant and has redeemed us from all sin and from death with his holy and precious blood and with his innocent suffering and dying. Christ has done this so that we may be his own, live in his kingdom, and serve him in eternal righteousness, innocence, and happiness. Since he, being risen from the dead, lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Our Savior has said, "Whoever hears my words and believes the one who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has already passed from death into life." We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, it is for the Lord that we live, and if we die, it is for the Lord that we die. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. For Christ died, rose from death, and lives again in order to be Lord of the living and of the dead. As a father has compassion on his children, so God has compassion on those who honor him. For he knows how we were formed. He remembers that we are dust. As a mother comforts her child, so will I comfort you, says the Lord. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down and sustains those who are bereaved, and God will wipe away all tears from their eyes.
Steadfast love the Lord lasts forever, and his goodness endures for all generations.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Thank you. Greetings, brothers and sisters. I don't know if you know what it feels like to be up front and hear you sing those words, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice, and to hear this sanctuary be filled with that. And having had quite a bit of experience with my dear brother, he always got the last word. And that is a word that is worth all of us hearing. And I'm not surprised that in this last song that we sang, he said, all will be well. That's Hopeton. And so this scripture verse that comes from Job also is a continued voice in his profession of faith, even in life and beyond. From Job. Where then does wisdom come from? Where does understanding dwell? It is hidden from the eyes of every living thing, concealed even from the birds in the sky. Now destruction and death say only a rumor of it has reached our ears. God understands the way to it. And God alone knows where it dwells. And God views the ends of the earth and sees everything under the heavens. And God established the force of the wind and measured out the waters. And God made a decree for the rain and a path for the thunderstorm. And then God looked at wisdom and appraised it. God confirmed it and tested it. And God said to the human race, the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom, and to shun evil is understanding.
Praise the Lord. I will be reading from St. Mark chapter 8, verses 31 through 38. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and rise again after 3 days. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. Get behind me, Satan, he said. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. Then he called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels. Amen.
The third scripture comes to us from Revelation 9, reading from verse 9, Revelation 7, reading from verse 9 through to 17. And this is being read by Hopeton's baby sister. Yes. After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. it's really unfair to have to go after that. It was awesome. It's really awesome. Hi, everyone. My name is Jadine, and I am the real favorite niece of my uncle. Some persons may have heard something different yesterday, but disregard that. All right. Not many have had the privilege of knowing Uncle Hopeton, or Uncle H. Most know Bishop Clennon, tour guide, Mr. Hopeton, or even a friend, but having an Uncle Hopeton is unparalleled. Hopeton's baby sister Betty, as she was fondly called by him and hated by her, is mother to me and my two sisters, Abigail and Catherine. Back home in Jamaica, we would know our Uncle Hopeton has arrived from the shouts of, "Hold dog! Who daya?" from the gate. My Uncle Hopeton's presence was felt. He was loud, yet gentle, tall, yet kind. He just seemed larger than life. Back when Toys R Us was still a place to behold, I remember how my sisters and I would be whisked away to this wonderful, magical land and told to pick up anything you wanted. What? Anything? I'm sure you can imagine the glow in our eyes and the joy in our hearts that was quickly dampened when our mother would say, "Anything small that can hold in your suitcase." There is not much that we wanted that my Uncle Hopeton wouldn't try to source. You had to be careful, though, because if you told him just one time that you liked something, he would remember and source it forever. There is not one trip that he took to Jamaica without bringing some gummy bears for me. And I think I told him that once when I was 10, so. He liked making others happy and would go out of his way to make it happen. Because of this, growing up, I thought my Uncle Hopeton was a millionaire. Not just because he was always giving to us, but because he was giving to everyone, anyone who was in need. It wasn't until I got older that I realized he was living the principle set by God in Luke chapter 6, verse 38. Give, and it will be given unto you, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. He lived this. And I'm confident that there is not one of you in here that would have turned my Uncle Hopeton away if he came to you in need. That good measure he gave was constantly running over in his life. And with it, he just gave more. My Uncle H was not only generous with his financial resources, but also his time and care. I experienced this firsthand about 10 years ago when my father died. My Uncle H was even more present and intentional in our lives, if you can even imagine. He found himself in Jamaica at least once a year and was only a phone call, WhatsApp message away with advice, jokes, and his iconic encouraging phrases like, "You rock! That's awesome! I knew I found the right Edwards." My Uncle Hopeton was energetic, always on the go, with an itinerary and a set of legal pads in hand. He also had unique moments of beatboxing when he was relaxed or working at home, when he would say something like, "Abukuyaka singala, sweet." All right, I didn't do it justice, but I think you get the point. My Uncle H enjoyed life with new trips or experiences. This last summer, he came to Jamaica again and sent the message, "What's new that I can do with Chester this time?" So Chester, you can thank me for that trip to Pelican Bar. In the final moments of his remarkable life, my Uncle Hopeton's focus was on the well-being of each and every one of us. I witnessed him fighting his last days to send final points of action and messages of encouragement. His profound wisdom echoed in these comforting words, assuring us that despite all the challenges, all will be well. Today, as we bid farewell to my Uncle Hopeton, I find solace in the bonds he fostered. After all, what comes with an uncle? Cousins. Andrew, Daniel, Hope, we are just a WhatsApp away. We'll be up here in a second. Call us. And I encourage us all to embrace his life of legacy, love, and generosity. Uncle Hopeton, thank you for everything. What good, brother? Your memory will shine forever bright in our hearts. Sweet!
Andrew, Shadeen should have gone last. Well, we saved the best for last. Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. Despite my parents' professions, I did not gain the public speaking gene, but I'm trying my best. It is a comfort to see each and every one of your faces and to know that there's more love outside these doors. My name is Danielle, and while I'm sure each and every one of you has a million stories you could share about Hopeton, the friend, the mentor, the pastor, the advisor, I wanted to share a bit about Hopeton the dad. Or Daddy-O, as I like to call him. This was exceptionally difficult to write, not just because I'm still processing the fact that he's gone home, but also because finding a way to synthesize the impact he's had on my life is nearly impossible. Ironically, he is the one I would turn to when I didn't know what to say. He just had a way of understanding someone's spirit that could make what's on your heart just naturally flow out of you. As I thought about what it was like for me to know him, I struggled to really find the words that aptly captures things like waking me up extra early on a snow day to tell me I didn't have to wake up. My dad had a way of just exploding perspective, and by that I mean he seemed to hold so many views about people and life that left him able to discuss any subject in great detail, and you walk away understanding the meaning of both and. As an easy example, I once asked him his favorite color. I think we landed on green, but not before a 20-minute discussion about the value of each color, how earth tones were clearly superior, and also he went to Calabar. While this may seem like a silly conversation between a 15-year-old and her dad, honestly, over the years, what I took from it is that it's so important to acknowledge and really examine the good that each person, thing, or interaction has to offer. My dad's lessons were really that experience was the lesson. He was fiercely dedicated to learning and growing by challenging himself, experiencing new things, and meeting new people. Something he told me when I was graduating high school has stuck with me, particularly on my birthdays. If you're the same person at 35 as you were at 25, you wasted 10 years. Because there's always a way to grow, and that's part of the beauty of this life. My dad was steadfast. There were many times that I would call him about a random thought I had, and we would talk for hours. Some of those calls were very much, Dad, what do I do? Dad, what do I do about this job? Dad, what do I do about this car? Dad, what do I do about this friend? He was always there to listen, but his ultimate response was, no matter what you choose, you'll be okay. Even when I was bawling on the phone because there was nothing I could do for a particular friend, he was steadfast in his reassurance. You're exactly where you need to be when they are ready to come to you for help. My dad was committed to helping others. When I came home from school with a B+, he'd say, what can I do to help? And while sometimes it's nice to just celebrate the win, there was something so sincere about his desire to help others on their journeys to become the best versions of themselves, or rather to see the best within themselves and put that into the world. I remember having a bully in grade school. My dad was often the one to pick me up, and I couldn't wait to complain about the trials and tribulations a 9-year-old me had to put up with thanks to this bully, and to be vindicated by my loving father. His response was to make sure that I was okay, of course, but after that, he wanted to know more about the bully. What class he was in, where he lived, things like that. I thought he might try to talk to his parents, embarrassing, or maybe even scare him a little, you know, don't mess with my daughter kind of thing. Instead, he got to know this kid. He got to know his family. When he picked me up, he'd make sure he said hi to him. When he'd come to my class to volunteer, he'd always make sure this kid was doing okay, and I was totally cool with it. No, it drove me crazy. This was my dad, and what was he doing fraternizing with the enemy? I didn't quite understand it at the time, and while I can't be 100% sure what his endgame was with those interactions, because I never asked him about it, though I wish I had, I will say for the rest of the year, that kid was no longer mean to me. We didn't become best friends or anything, but my life was much easier in class after that. And looking back, I'm just in awe of the man who instinctively sought to move upstream and see that hurt people, and maybe they just need to know one more person in the world is in their corner. That was my dad, a man who looked for the positives. With the news of his passing, it's been beautiful to read and hear how he has touched so many lives in so many different ways. One recurring theme that has stuck out to me is the idea that the world may be a darker place for having lost him. I challenge those with that mindset to shift their perspective. One of my dad's greatest gifts was his ability to shine a light on the gifts of others and invite all to come as they are with what they can. While he believed each and every one of us to be special, he didn't make us special. He just shone a light on what was already there. One flame can light a million candles, as they say. And so I think the lights of those he has met will continue to make the world a brighter place. And so with that, I will say, rest easy in the kingdom of heaven, Dad. We know all will be well. Thank you.
They really should have had the firstborn go first, you know? I'm not supposed to follow up this. Good morning. If we haven't met yet, I am Andrew. I am Hopeton's son. Thank you all for coming. You would have been blessed and overjoyed that you all would have been here. I was fortunate enough to have two incredible people that instilled in me their best qualities, as well as an implicit need to do the right thing. With this passing, it was the little things I kind of noticed. He used to fix my collars on days like today. I'd be 26, 27-year-old going to, you know. It was strange getting ready today knowing that that wouldn't happen again. But all would be well, as my dad would say. He kind of sort of just knew when to say it, too. Whatever it is you were going through, all will be well. Dad was phenomenal, but I really came to appreciate him when I got older. He was always father and son, but instead of teaching and educating and reprimanding, because I was a dumb kid, we had a lot of deep conversations. He saw me more as like, I was always a son, but he saw me as kind of like a peer. He would value my input. He would always lead with empathy. He was never condescending. When I would come to him with things and we could just talk. He would tell me how much he enjoyed the conversations we had like that. Every family get together, anytime we had a random bite to eat, I'd look forward to us talking. Even if we ended up disagreeing, it was just all would be well, you know? When it became a possibility that it may no longer be the case, that we could talk. I wanted to make sure that I told him when I was 14, 15, I was in scouts. I would go on trips over summer, over the weekend, and he would come. He was a photographer, as you all know. He loved taking pictures. Now, me being the 14, 15-year-old boy, I want to play with my friends, right? I remember specifically, he was taking our picture, this is as he does, and me, as I would do at that time, was dismissive and rude and just wanted playtime. We went to go eat, and after the plane was done, I went looking for my dad because I wanted to go see him. I looked around the whole campsite and I went to go talk to somebody. They told me he had left about the time when I was being a little dumb kid. I held on to that till I saw him on the hospital bed, maybe the 26th. And I kind of knew I had to tell him. It went from having a plan, something was going to happen, to this might be the last time I get to talk to him. At that moment, I know I felt so much shame. And it's been eating up at me since I was a kid. And the first thing he said to me was, "What's important is you came looking for me, and all would be well." That was my dad. I didn't get a chance to say goodbye to him. So goodbye, Dad, until I see you again.
Seated. So it was on Sunday, December 17th, which is the third Sunday in Advent, the Sunday traditionally dedicated in our tradition to joy, that the Right Reverend Hopeton Clennon preached his last formal sermon. So this is not on record because we only live stream our 11 o'clock service. So this is how I remember it. But at the 9 o'clock Old Chapel service, Hopeton walked out into the aisle, kind of did a combination between inviting our children to see and inviting all of us to see. And he held up a picture of a rainbow. And he said to us, "So what do you do when you see a rainbow?" And instinctually, all of us knew, and all of you know, what do? You say, "Look, there's a rainbow," right? Think about it the next time. Even though we all know it's a rainbow, but there's something inside of us that says, "Look, there's a rainbow." And then he said, "Well, why do we do this?" And he said, "Because seeing a rainbow brings a sense of joy. And when we feel joy, we want to point it out. We want to share it with another. Look, there's a rainbow." That's the thing about Hopeton. He lived a life pointing out what we might not see in ourselves, in a situation, in others. He lived a life pointing to a rainbow of joy, to the gifts within us, and at the same time, pointing out the joy that we could have within, his own joyful, dedicated, thoughtful living. As the psalmist writes in the conclusion of Psalm 16, "You have showed me the path of life. In your presence there is the fullness of joy." So you know, when Hopeton pointed to you, or when he said, "Come," if it was in his office or wherever he was, or when he invited you into a conversation, you were that rainbow. You were the center of his attention, and didn't matter if you were a five-year-old child coming up for a children's message, a visitor off the street, if he knew you or didn't know you, you were the most important thing right then, valued that moment's rainbow. And so today's memoir is simply doing what Hopeton preached on December 17th, pointing out a life well-lived, so that we can all say, "Look, there's God's rainbow," pointing out his love for God, his love for neighbors, defined in that Good Samaritan neighbor way. The neighbors are all of God's children, and his love for himself, remembering to be joyful. This is my favorite Hopeton sermon, the greatest commandment of loving God, neighbor, and ourselves. And maybe I'm realizing now it's my favorite because I saw it not only in how he preached it, but how he lived it. So Conrad Leopold Hopeton Clennon was born March 25th, 1960 in Kingston, Jamaica, baptized at Bethany Brethren Church in 1960, confirmed in 1971 at Trinity Moravian Church in Jamaica. Pictured in the amazing photographs we have in the back of our bulletin is a photo of his family, Enos and Iris May Clennon, his sisters, Yvette Joy, Bethenia, Andrea, and Denise. And there's one joyful-looking boy in that photo, Conrad Hopeton Clennon. So Hopeton grew up attending and graduating in 1976 from Calabar High School, where his classmate and friend Albert Edwards writes fondly of his legacy of faith and community and kingdom building. Hopeton would go on to graduate from the University of the West Indies and the United Theological College of the West Indies, and then receive ordination into the Jamaica province of the Moravian Church in 1983. His first call was to serve congregations in rural western Jamaica, the Salem circuit of the Moravian churches, which colleagues told me that he joyfully received, even though sometimes those rural congregations weren't the first choices or the ideal choices. From 1985 until his call to Faith Moravian Church in Washington, D.C., he then served the Zorn Circuit of the Moravian Churches in Jamaica. While there, in this call, Hopeton had the chance to marry Sheila Johnson, July 23rd, 1988, or as he called her, my beautiful wife. Their love was one of the greatest joys of Hopeton's life, and I'd often witness that if she was calling and his face would light up, or witness them together. Soon the call of the church would take them to Washington, D.C., where Hopeton would now serve within the northern province of the Moravian Church. So Hopeton served at Faith Moravian from 1990 to 1994 before accepting the call to Schoeneck Moravian Church in Nazareth until 1999. While at Schoeneck, Hopeton was elected and consecrated as the 320th bishop of the worldwide Moravian unity. From Schoeneck, he would then serve Downey Moravian in California from 1999 to 2008, before then returning to the Lehigh Valley, accepting the role as chaplain of Moravian College then and Theological Seminary until 2012. It was a little over 10 years ago that Hopeton accepted this call to serve as senior pastor of Central Moravian Church. As he served here, he had the opportunity to expand ministries, serving into the community in so many areas that I'm probably forgetting some, I apologize, but serving on the Bach Choir Board, Rotary, the Board of Trustees for the Moravian Theological Seminary and Moravian University, the Ordination Review Committee, Faith and Order, among many others. Hopeton showed others the joy and the gifts that we could have within ourselves, and is especially remembered here at Central for the ways that he was so empowering others of lay leadership, of how we all could serve and lead joyfully, maybe because you couldn't say no to him, we're remembering. But joy is certainly how we have been remembering him here at Central. So in addition to his beautiful wife, Sheila, Hopeton's joys were his children, Hope Elizabeth, Andrew, and Danielle. I found his membership form that we have folks join as he joined the church when he was serving as chaplain, filling out in 2009. And I found it interesting, we have a place for skills and hobbies or something like that. And he listed three. The first was mentioned, photography. We are maybe wondering, just how many pictures did you take? And where are they all? The second is philately. Now, for those of you who don't know, this is the treasured hobby of stamp collecting, of which he was. And the third, he listed as cruise tours. And many, many of us know the delight in his eyes and his voice as he would talk about where he was guiding the next group. If it was Jamaica, of course, but also the UNESCO World Heritage Sites in Europe, in the Middle East, the Holy Lands, in Alaska, and so many more places. And this points out to me that joy in ministry for Hopeton was so much more than what we might classify or think of ministry at first glance. It was about everything in life. It was about relationships and travel and connections and pointing out that ways that we could be the joy for others. So in June of 2023, just this last June, Central celebrated with Hopeton as he marked 40 years of ordained ministry. And in some ways, he wrote in the June newsletter to our congregation, 40 years as a pastor feels like a long time. But in many ways, he said, it feels like the twinkling of an eye. I am deeply grateful for those 40 years that have brought so much joy. And we echo, Hopeton, do you know how much joy you brought to others? Ever mindful of his creator and the source from whom where he got all that he had been given. Hopeton ended this article in our newsletter by giving thanks to God. He writes, "For the grace, mercy, and love that has brought me thus far, and for my fellow pilgrims along this journey of faith." We are all journeying, some of us closer to the end of this earthly life than others. But on this journey, as Job writes, searching for wisdom. It was fitting that the end of Hopeton's earthly journey ended on a day of completion, the seventh day of January, as Shelia had reflected. "You showed me the path of life," he might have echoed the psalmist. And now, in God's more immediate presence, Brother Hopeton is finding the fullness of joy. Amen.
My dear friends, I'm about to lead in the closing prayer, but let me, before I pray, say a few words. That was what I signed up for. It is difficult and maybe pointless to conceal the shock and the solemnity and the sadness of a moment like this, but I just want to say thanks to those who have given the memoirs and the tributes to help to, in a way, mitigate the sense of anxiety that I face coming to a moment like this. So what can I say? What can one say? This was the sense of agony that was expressed in Jesus' words in John 27 and verse 12, where he says, "Now my soul is troubled, and what can I say?" In his closing moments, Brother Hopeton also expressed that sense of agony. "Hun, what should I do? What should I do?" This is a question he asked Shelia on the day of his passing. And it is a question for us to ponder. And in a moment, I will come back to the story of that question. Brother Hopeton, Brother Clennon, Bishop Clennon, Pastor Clennon, and for those of us who were in college with him, Penroy, was a unique person. Of course, everyone is unique, but what I mean is that in him, we saw qualities that are rare. Preacher, yes, leader, administrator, organizer, manager, son, brother, father, husband, pastor, friend, he was all these, and others are these too. However, there is a rare quality that he possessed, which we see in relatively few people, an ability by which hundreds, maybe thousands, and certainly we who are here today have been affected and impacted by it. And that was his ability to connect people and be connected to people. It is that ability which caused every one of us here to feel that we are special to him. We're special in a special way. And when this quality is superimposed upon other rudimentary qualities, we get a person who has an ability to create a pandemic in a positive way. We got a feel of this when With only a few hours' notice, about 250 people joined a Zoom prayer meeting. A little pandemic. One writer speaks of persons who have this, who have such impact that they can create these little moments of epidemic. They turn ordinary moments into a tipping point. He refers to those persons as connectors. And that is what Brother Hopeton was, a connector. People who are important, not simply because of the number of persons that they know, but because of the kinds of people they know, and also because of the importance they give to the people they know. A connector. Hopeton was a connector. And like connectors, Hopeton, he was curious. He took personal interest in each person he met. Connectors are self-confident, sociable, likable, full of energy, and in Hopeton's case, full of smiles and laughter. In Hopeton's case, you add to those qualities of connectors and you get a man with qualities of faith, gentle, gracious, God-fearing, and we get a super connector who willingly supports us in our journey of faith and in our connection with God. That is why we feel so connected to him in a personal way. Speaking of Hopeton, people are more inclined to say, he is my friend. Owning him in a special way because we know he owned us in a special way, specific way. No one after meeting him comes away and said, he's my acquaintance. No. He's a treasured friend. And that is why we each have personal stories and photographic evidence of that personal connection. I have been consumed with Facebook stories since his passing, as if I cannot afford to miss a story. I mean, you can go there and you can read those stories if you see the point I'm making. But we each have a personal story that we can tell. And that is the quality of a super connector. And speaking of stories, my reflection today was influenced by a story Sheila shared. I was not aware of his passing when I sent a text that morning inquiring of how he was. I sent the text to Sheila. He had passed 40 minutes before. And let me read in full Sheila's response. I got her permission. Your brother passed at noon today. He was at peace. He woke up and asked me, "Hun, what should I do?" I asked him, "Hun, what do you want?" He asked me the same question again, "Hun, what should I do?" I said, "Hun, it's okay to go home. He's at peace." I have spent several days turning over in my mind that question, what should I do? I was helped in some way as I turned to John 27, verse 12 and verse 27. And here Jesus said, "My soul is troubled. And what can I say? Father, save me from this hour." Through this text, I hear Hopeton in his final moments as a man in anguish, evidently sensing the dawning of a moment of transition, seeking as he does another perspective. He's not consumed with his wisdom. He was modest. He was not a know-it-all kind of a person. In humility, seeking help. Not bubbling with confidence about the implications of the moment, but asking, what should I do? That question to Sheila represents a questioning of faith and of God, not knowing What way to turn? What should I do? Standing at the crossroad of life, what should I do? We who are here today hearing this, we now know of his anguish in those final hours, agonizing about what was best for this moment, seeking guidance in a moment of anguish. This question will occupy our minds in the coming days. What should I do? Now that my friend is gone, what should I do? Pastor has died, what should I do? Our bishop is gone, what shall we do? Who will pick up what he has relinquished? Who will become the connector? Who will be the organizer? Who will provide the inspiration? Who will be the pastor? Who will be the friend to take more than just passing interest in others? Hopeton's question is our question. What should I do? And so I ask you, my dear brothers and sisters, you who have been affected and impacted by his connection, know that our brother has made his transition. What will you do? Let us pray. Gracious God, you lead us through the changes of time to the rest and blessedness of our eternal home. Be near us now to comfort and sustain us. Help us to keep faith in the affirmation that we who hope in you and all people are precious in your sight. Secure us in the belief that we live forever with you. We thank you for Hopeton, whose life we had the privilege to share. Help us to trust you as now by death we part from him. Dear God, give us all who mourn for him, but especially Sheila and Daniel and Betty and Joy and the whole family, your strength in this moment of grief and loss. Grant that we will more bravely seek to be more faithful to you, more loving and helpful to others, following those who, like Hopeton, are no longer on earth with us. We pray that we, by your mercy, in our turn and in your time, will find the perfect and unending rest in God. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Just before I start leading the conclusion of memorial service, you'll please allow me just about maybe 52 seconds to share a message from the bishops of the Northern Province. This is offered by Bishop K. Ward. These are times when our hearts are so broken that at first we may not be able to say thank you. That is the reason we have gathered here today, to give thanks for the life of Bishop Hopeton Clennon. For a time, there were eight of us, eight Northern Province bishops. Now, there are seven. We are no longer whole. We will be missing that smiling face in the eighth square of our Zoom call next month. We are already missing his laughter and his zest for life. Hopeton was given the same number of hours in a day that we all are given, but he lived much more than 24 hours a day. His hours were filled with inquisitiveness, a passion for people, all people, and a keen mind that could clarify and focus a conversation, no matter the topic. In Hopeton, we could glimpse the joy of a life well lived, serving and loving his Savior. Love never dies. There is so much love that we give to Hopeton, and so much love that he gave to us and to the world. And love never dies. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me will live, and though they die. And those who live and believe in me will never die. Therefore, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Yes, says the Spirit, they will rest from their labor. Where death is your victory, where grave is your sting. It is sin which gives death its power, and it is a law which gives sin its strength. All thanks to God who delivered us from the fear of death, the power of sin, and the condemnation of the law. Thanks be to God who gave us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Keep us in everlasting fellowship with the heavenly church triumphant, and let us rest together in your presence from our labors. Glory be to him who is the resurrection and the life. Even though we die, he give us life now and forever. Glory be to Christ in the church which waits for him on earth, and in the church which is around him in heaven, forever and ever.
Thank you.
Hopeton wrote to us only 2 weeks ago. There is hope and peace in this life with family and friends in our ministry and service on earth. There is a promise of greater blessing in the eternal life to come. All will be well. All will be well. And it was St. Julian of Norwich who said, "All shall be well, all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well. For there is a force of love moving through the universe that holds us fast and will never let us go." Amen. You may be seated as we continue to worship through our postlude.